come from behind victory up at Providence, Rhode Island last year.
Two free throws for the Bulls back on top by three. 31-28 with 2.5 to go. How important for the Bulls to go into the halftime locker room with the lead and a little confidence.
That and also some confidence in knocking down some free throws.
Look at the zone extend. Three up near the logo for the Bulls defensively. Bennett will back it out. 16 to go on the shot. Coaching 2 minutes and a half. Crosses over on Noriega to the corner. Callaway, partially blocked by Poland. He gets the outlet, one-on-one. Back out to Noriega, not a clean catch, otherwise he had a dagger waiting for him.
Yo, Stan, he's just jumping up and down, asking, what is he doing? You've been unconscious the first half. You have to let that one ride, Mr. Noriega.
Bulls will be hard-pressed to get a better one right here. Haynes to Poland, Noriega passes on another. Pulls up, 15-footer, sweet off the glass.
If Sean Noriega gets that into his repertoire, he's going to be a very difficult player to defend.
Well, it's been happening at the offensive end, but I think it's really started with this zone defensively. It seems to have elevated the tempo for the Bulls. Cadell silences the crowd.
Was there anything Cadell cannot do to put the basketball in the hoop? Waiting for him to headbutt one in.
He has a dozen to lead the Terriers. 1 minute to go in the first half.
1 minute.
Haynes on Callaway. Noriega lines it up.
Did you get an invitation to this party? Because he's coming out tonight.
36-31. Terriers had a chance to go 2-for-1. Instead, they'll be patient on the offensive end. Harrington off the mark. Fitzpatrick the board. Now the Bulls can take the last shot. Stan Heath wants a timeout. He'll get it.
Great job that time by Shedrick Haynes. Understanding time and score and looking over to Stan Heath to see what he wanted to do.
The Bulls have put together 13 2-runs and now a 7-3 stretch. Really put themselves in front. And I think after the loss on Friday, to go into the halftime locker room against a team from a mid-major conference, a low-major conference, will give them a shot in the arm. And he's giving them a shot in the arm. Man with a couple cannons on his arm. Noriega, he dropped weight, you told me, in the offseason. He's come back a new man.
Yeah, he has dropped off some weight. He really has worked on his body. I tell you what else he's worked on, his confidence, where he are here. You see Mr. Noriega just letting it fly from deep. And I'm going to tell you what's really, you know, you watch every shot that he takes. I haven't seen too many of these shots hit the rim. I mean, this is all net, JB. Nothing's touching the rim. Perfect rotation, great eyesight. Ball hasn't touched the rim yet. I would hate to play him in that game of horse where he actually calls his shot where it's not touching the rim. It's one thing to make it.
Stan Heath was raving about this kid, Noriega. I talked to him on media day, and I said, no, what kind of range does this guy have? He says, you want to see it? He rolls the ball out to the hash mark. Noriega hadn't even warmed up. He was just stepping on the court. He says, Sean, shoot this. Sean says, from here? Coach Heath says, yeah. Buried it, just like the ones we were seeing there. Nothing but net.
Yeah, I mean, Sean, a lot of people were asking questions, you know, why was USF recruiting this kid, as a senior? And Coach Stan Heath told me this is the ability to shoot the basketball, and I had an opportunity to watch him play at Northport. And, I mean, he has unlimitless range. I mean, and that's something you really just can't coach.
10 seconds to defend now. Bulls protecting a 5-point lead going into the break. Callaway drives, has it taken away by Poland. At midcourt with five. Look out below! DeJuan's opponent! For a 7-point halftime lead. What a play!
Jumanji DeJuan's up! Just when you thought USF had given away the momentum, DeJuan's opponent coming up with the steal. And you know what? I'm sending one home to you. How about that?
USF closes the half on a 9-3 run. Poland puts him in front at the break. a lot for Leroy Selman to be happy about. His USF Bulls beat St. Francis 38-31 here at the half. His Tampa Bay Buccaneers are 6-3 on the season after a win over Carolina on Sunday. And his football Bulls still in contention for a potential BCS bid because of this overtime win at Louisville, 24-21 on Saturday. What a catch by Dontavia Bogan in the back of the end zone from B.J. Daniels. Adaris Bellamy, a former USF signee, gave the Cardinals a lead back, but Mike Lombanani, who missed one at the end of regulation, booted a game-winning 37-yard field goal in overtime, and the Bulls become bowl eligible for the sixth straight year. Demetrius Murray also rushed for 100-plus in the win. So you look at the Big East standings, and there is still a whole lot to be decided. USF controls its destiny against every team except Syracuse and West Virginia. They need help there. They play Saturday at noon against Pittsburgh. The Bulls do at Raymond James Stadium with the chance to knock off Pittsburgh. The Panthers right now the top team in the conference. And we continue the theme here with all of the success in the USF athletic department. Now we're privileged to be joined by Denise Schulte Brown, who heads up the USF women's soccer program. They have had an absolute banner year. You led the team to the Big East final, the first win in NCAA tournament history for your program. Come up just a goal shy on Sunday against Florida State. But, Coach, tell us how excited you are and proud of what the program accomplished this season.
I'm really proud of the girls. It's still really fresh because it was just yesterday. And I thought the girls fought really hard and left it all on the field. And it really could be us in the Sweet 16. And it's nice to see that two of the teams that we've just previously beaten are in the Sweet 16. So it says a lot about our program and the growth of the program. And I'm sad to see the last game for my seniors. They were awesome, but we're a young team, and I think we have a huge future, so I'm excited about that.
Well, we talked about mid-season when this group was still trying to find its identity, and the surging junior class was really where a lot of the energy has come from. That must leave you really optimistic about what lies ahead for the program.
Oh, absolutely. We're really, really young, and we're anchored by two sophomores at center back and a sophomore forward that, kissed the post twice here in the playoffs to make a difference, Taylor Patterson. So we're really excited about the future. There's a lot about women's soccer that fans can get excited about, and we've had amazing support here. We have these guys that are here today. They've been out at our games. They traveled to Tallahassee. So it's been a great experience being a part of USF excitement, really.
Now with an NCAA berth under your belt, you can go on the road and recruit, and that's something you can really sell to young women across the country who want to play at the highest level.
Yeah, I've always really believed in the team and believed in our progress, and I think the product here at USF sells itself, but it is nice to see us in the top 25 in the print. That's kind of nice.
Denise Schulte Brown, congratulations on a terrific season, and good luck on the recruiting trail and enjoying that little thing we like to call the off season, which I know is a total misnomer, right?
Starting right now.
Thanks for being with us.
Thanks a lot.
Denise Schulte Brown and the women's soccer team, a tremendously successful season. And the Bulls basketball team on top of St. Francis, 38-31 at the half. We'll be back with some statistics and a look ahead to the second 20 minutes right after this. We're at halftime at the Sun Dome in Tampa, South Florida 38, St. Francis 31. And while we have a minute, why don't we take a look and see the Sunday scoreboard from the Big East Conference. A lot of teams getting a jump start on this 2010-2011 season. Marquette by 11 over Bucknell. Notre Dame 72-51, overcoming a slow shooting night to beat Liberty. Notre Dame adjusting to life without Luke Herangode in the Big East. Seton Hall and Syracuse both winners. Again, the Orange, a top 15 team. Rick Jackson playing well, and they've got this 7-foot freshman, if you haven't heard about him, Fab Mello, a name to get to know. We are at halftime here at USF, and as you look around those scores, maybe just a quick thought on the Big East and what we might see in the months ahead.
Well, I don't think the Big East has dropped by any means as far as the amount of teams you'll be having to go to the postseason NCAA tournament. Again, it's just one of the most premier conferences in all of sports. And I wouldn't surprise me if you see, again, 7, 8, 9 teams make it to postseason play. I mean, Syracuse is going to be extremely good. They expect UConn to have a down year. There's no way I'll put the chips on that happening.
The Bulls picked 13th out of 18th in the preseason poll, but at least one opposing coach says, no way. We'll tell you that story as we go through the second half. Right now, the Bulls on top. We're getting set for the second 20 minutes of play here at the Sun Dome. 38-31 our score. First half highlights and statistics right after this. USF 38, St. Francis 31. We're at halftime here in Tampa, but the Terriers jumped out to a 14-7 lead as we take a look at our first half highlights. The halftime score tells, well, only part of the story. Akeem Bennett with a hot start.
Well, JB, we all knew about Cadell, but again, Akeem Bennett coming out and knocking down three, showing his strength and ability to penetrate to the basket.
Sean Noriega was 0-for-3 from distance in the opener. A completely different tale tonight.
Well, he just wants to make sure you erase that night, not only from his memory, but from all USF fans' memory, really coming out and being lights out in the first half.
And how about Juwan Zapolin to end the half at both ends, the steal and the slam, and that's how we have this 38-31 USF lead. As we look at the first half statistics, Andrew Frazier, what jumps out at you?
Again, both teams shooting the ball well from behind the arc. 6 of 10 for St. Francis, 6 of 14. And USF's ability to get to the free throw line really is a difference in this ballgame.
The 2-3 zone for USF has been a spark in both games they've played so far. They showed it primarily in the second half against Southern Miss. Went to it a bit earlier here in this first half. I think it really got them going.
Well, you need a momentum changer sometimes. The St. Francis really were just spreading USF too far out. The Bigs were having a hard time not only recovering on ball screens, but also preventing penetration. The 2-3 zone allowed them to get easier rotations and to make sure they rebounded the basketball as a ball club.
What do you look for in the second half?
Well, I look for another healthy dose of both players from the outside who've been killing so far. Lights out, Bennett, and also Noriega. But if USF wants to stay in this basketball game, they have to stop Cadell and Bennett. Right now, Cadell and Bennett are 9 for 16 from the field combined. The rest of St. Francis, 3 for 11.
USF has not lost to St. Francis since Andrick Frazier ditched the tie and was in gym shorts. So try and keep that streak alive when we come back in the second half.
Thanks.
Here we go with the second half of play. St. Francis and USF from the Sun Dome in Tampa. The Bulls with a 38-31 lead. Alongside Andrick Frazier, I'm J.B. Long. Sir, give us your halftime adjustments.
Well, you know, there are really two things that turned the tide in the first half. You talked about USF going to their 2-3 zone, but I think it was also St. Francis having to rely on a 2-3 zone because they got a couple of players in foul trouble. You know, right now, Berunichik has 3, Bennett has 2, Harrington has 2, and so does Richard Clark. And one thing St. Francis did an excellent job in the first half where they put so much ball pressure, it distorted some of the passing angles into the post. In USF, it was completely opposite. They allowed themselves to use their size advantage and pack the ball in.
Same starting lineup for both teams. We're underway here in the second half. And Stan Heath has said that he can substitute very easily. There's almost 2 players at every position, and that's almost his best disciplinary tool. If you make a mistake, you're coming out because the guy behind you doesn't lose much slack.
And there were some games last year where Dominique Jones and Chris Howard had to log 40 minutes a game, you know, on the several nights. So that's not going to be the case at all this year.
Runicic has to put it up with 7 on the shot clock. And on the backside, Poland called for a foul as he went up the defensive rebound.
Well, I'm going to tell you one thing. Coach Stan Heath in practice last week was getting on Jawanza Poland about actually turning and locating the body to box out because he's so athletically gifted. And what you'll find, young man, this is no longer junior college. In the Big East, you'll end up being on somebody's poster or on top 10, which is even worse.
See if St. Francis has another early run in it. They started quick in the first half of play. Callaway goes right around Crater, stops to shoot over the trees, and somehow gets it back on the rebound. Perunicic, a clean look from 3.
Anthony Crater, he has 2 fouls. He doesn't want to pick up the 3rd because he wants to stay on the 4, but Callaway has yet to really do any damage from the outside. Just keep him in front.
Perunicic now 3 for 3 from the arc. Look at Gilchrist go. He had to retrieve it, able to put it down.
Well, Augustus Gilchrist had that made up in his mind when he caught that basketball. That one was going up.
Quiet first half for him, only 3 points, all on one field goal, that three-pointer from the top of the arc. Goodell with a little pump and go, misses the layup, famous. Now has control of the rebound. Crater will push. Cullen inside Gilchrist. Loose ball rebound, Goodell has it. Bennett goes baseline, challenges Poland, who takes the charge.
Jawan's at that time, high basketball IQ. You have to meet the opposing defender outside the paint. There you see Jawan's getting outside of the paint, 2 feet planted, taking one on the chin for the team.
Landrick, you mentioned the fouls becoming a factor. That's now three on Bennett, who has 11 points for St. Francis.
You take Bennett and Ricky Caudill out of this game right here, and they've accounted for almost two-thirds of the points for St. Francis.
Stan Heath, who goes to his bench first, replacing Jared Famous with Ron Anderson. He rotates to Crater. Poland sets his feet off the mark, but a loose ball foul. Harrington shoved Anderson, who went to the offensive glass. The Bulls will keep it. Third foul on Alex Harrington.
What an advantage you have if you're a player such as Ron Anderson. You've watched so much basketball in your life growing up, and you know his father has taught him all the tricks of the trade. You saw earlier how he held his seal, you know, used his arm bar to prevent some space. He didn't really have to be overly athletic to make that shot. Same thing there. He's just a very crafty player for his age.
Milos Trivic, number 12, checks in for St. Francis. Promptly takes a foul as Gilchrist went by him on the baseline. Trivic, a fellow Serbian, along with Perunicic, appearing for the first time tonight.
Milos Trivic, that's his first team's third.
Talk about that motor with Augustus Gilchrist. You can see he's playing with just a different, you know, sense of urgency here in this half than he did in the first half.
Yeah, someone lit a fire under him at halftime. Above his head and passes it to Robertson. A one-on-one move, left hand, can't put it down. St. Francis clears the glass and runs. Callaway lost control. Now Poland working one-on-two, has help to his left with Robertson. One too many passes, I think, and a foul.
It's a very active basketball team. You're talking about hands on the floor right here, and Anthony Crater coming up, poking the ball out. Jawanza Poland trying to get the ball pushed ahead, and Robertson just being unselfish and really wanting to reward Ron Anderson Jr.
Those big boys run the floor. You do want to get them a bucket. And already four quick team fouls on St. Francis. Bulls are going to be in the bonus in no time. Full shot clock for the Bulls to work with. Crater at the top. Anderson finds Gilchrist. You have to respect that three-point shot. He's already made one from the top. 16 on the shot. Crater into Anderson. Turns baseline. Ron Anderson.
What really creates the great position for Ron Anderson is just how hard he sets that baseline screen. I mean, he pinned Anthony Crater's man underneath the basket that time. He had to fight through a screen, which forced his man to help out, which allowed him to be wide open on the baseline side.
Already 3 minutes and change gone in the second half. USF on top, 42-34. 10 on the shot clock for Smelski. He'll have to go. Working on Crater. Cadell with five. May have carried it. Gets away on the baseline, and that's going to be a tough foul to take with just two on the shot clock. USF picks up a cheapie.
Well, Jawan's a Poland really just bailing Cadell out. Lonzo right there has about a 6'6 advantage. As long as he stays within arm's length, stays in his stance, he'll have an opportunity to get up on Cadell's shot if he does decide to pull up the jumper.
Perunicic with the baseline inbound for the Terriers. Just one field goal for St. Francis in the second half so far.
USF again going to the 2-3 zone out of the underneath out of bounds play.
A deep three for Cadell, too strong. Look at Robertson go and get the board. Numbers if he hurries. Finds Poland. Right back to Robertson. He hesitated on the three, and that's why. One extra pass, and the Bulls get a bucket. deep behind the play. A terrier is down. That is Perunicic. He is writhing in pain and gripping that right shoulder.
He was actually trying to grab behind his neck. I really couldn't tell what happened. If he just landed awkwardly when he was coming down and it, you know, jarred his back. But look at Robertson, caught him with an elbow kind of right in the pit of the back. Nothing intentional, just, you know, Robinson trying to spread himself out and come down with a clean rebound.
Well, he has certainly been a factor for St. Francis so far. This after a miserable shooting night in the opening loss at Boston College. He was 0 for 9 from the three-point line.
Well, both he and Noriega must have found the same fountain to drink out of, because they've surely found their range to see.
Yeah, no kidding.
Hopefully he can get up and walk off on his own power.
See the Bulls faithful giving him a nice round of applause. He's on his feet and walking off. That does not look like a man who is going to be able to return to this game, though. He is contorted, to say the least. And again, still reaching for that back. I think you spotted it well, Andrick. He caught an elbow right in the soft spot.
Not a lot of muscle on your back, but if it does find one, it could knot up in a hurry.
Just to go back to the play at the other end, the Bulls capitalizing on the man advantage. Some nice passing, secondary break. Ron Anderson gets the bucket.
Again, you know, Ron Anderson, I don't know if you recall, but he's the person that got a hand up on the shot down here, and he beats everyone down the court for another easy two.
USF has scored six straight. Now they're in the half-court trap. Nice double. Milk, good look to inside. Milos Trivic cashes in.
Well, that's one you just have to live with. Coach Tanheath understands that. I mean, that was just two great passes to get the easy layup by St. Francis.
That breaks a bit of a drought for the Terriers. Now Crater working against the man-to-man defense. Gilchrist has come out with new fire in the second half. Here's Poland, who's really been a spark again tonight. Gilchrist wants another three. Nothing there. They'll go over the end line and over St. Francis. Our first break of the second half. USF leading 44-36, and the depth and conditioning starting to show. Turnovers were a problem early for the Bulls, but they now have a 44-36 lead, and part of what they've picked up, Andrew Frazier, the passing.
You know, one of the things you definitely want to focus in on, you know, when you have an opportunity to look at a stat sheet, you know, is the ability to knock down shots. And right here, USF has 16 field goals, and 12 of those have been assisted. I mean, that tells that you're sharing the basketball.
coming off a tough loss in the opener to Southern Miss, but all was not lost in that game. Obviously, an early test from a team that could be an NCAA team out of Conference USA, and Coach Larry Eustacy had high praise for these Bulls. That was as well coached as any team I've seen, he says. That is not the 13th place team in the Big East. That is a well-oiled machine. They're going to just get better and better. I really think Stan Heath has turned the corner with this program. Again, this coming off a year in which the Bulls put together a 20-win season and then lost the first-round draft pick in program history. So that's saying something to expect even higher and bigger things from the Bulls in 2010 and 11.
Even though Coach Eustacy doesn't have the history that USF or Southern Miss have, I mean, being old foes in the Metro and the Conference USA, I mean, everybody around the country, I think, has now come to respect what Stan Heath has been able to do as a head coach.
Matt Milk with the chance to convert a three-point play here. As he drops the bucket and can cut the lead to five.
This is something you just can't allow to happen, I mean, especially out of a timeout. And Shedrick Haynes coming right down to get another seed and a talking to by Coach Heath. The coach is telling him, son, you just checked in the ball game. That's your man. You got to stay between your man and the basket.
Milk scoreless in the first game of his career at Boston College, has five in this one, and the lead is five for USF. Poland has it taken away with some full court pressure. Cadell with the steal. The 15-minute mark, another possession for St. Francis.
Jawanza Poland has to run that basketball all the way into his hands, and then he has to grip it. Just way too careless right there with the basketball.
Trivich kicks to Cadell. Crosses over on Poland, lets him get baseline. Gets the ball up, and he was fouled. Fitzpatrick will be tagged with it, and just what you were talking about.
Cadell is just so crafty, but I think right now Mr. Jawanza Poland is going to take a seat somewhere close to Stan Heath. If I were him, I'd walk as far away as possible. I mean, not only was he careless with the basketball and giving the turnover, but he fell asleep on Cadell and came right out of his stand, stood straight up, and Cadell, being a senior crafty ball player that he is, crossed him right over and found a way to the basket.
Poland will take a seat, replaced by Hugh Robertson. And that was the challenge for the red shirt out of Hutchinson Community College in Wichita, Kansas. You know, Stan Heath challenging to play better defense to get him more minutes. He wants him in the game, but you can only be in there until your defense becomes a liability. You know, he's one of those guys who can get you 15 but give up 20, and then it's a plus-minus situation.
I mean, these are just facts I'm going to state. Look at a Jawanza Poland, look at Sean Noriega, and if you go down a checklist of kind of what you want in one of your wing players, there's no doubt about it that Jawanza Poland is a much more athletic player. He has the ability to guard and defend, but right now he just hasn't gotten there mentally on the defensive end. Sean Noriega's there, and if Sean Noriega had Jawanza Poland's athletic ability, he'd be an all-Big East caliber player.
Double-digit turnovers now on the evening for USF, and back-to-back. Another possession for St. Francis. Tough nose drive by Callaway, but Robertson gets the tie-up, and on the possession era, it'll be Bulls basketball.
Here again, it's too easy a penetration that time, given up by the guard point guards. You have to keep your man in front of you. This is about the time on Friday where things started to unravel for USF against Southern Miss. So let's see if they've learned a lesson from last Friday and can find a way to get some points on the board.
Six unanswered points for the Terriers. We'll see if USF can break the drought. Robertson to Noriega. He has a step on the baseline. Goes strong to the rim. It's tipped out of bounds. Last touch by Ron Anderson.
Situations like these, I like to see the point guard pull the ball out. I understand the motion offense has been running well. Run a set play. Run a play to get Ron Anderson pinning his man underneath the basket because he's had success down there. Or run a play to get Sean Noriega coming off a couple of screens just to get your confidence back up.
Nice feed inside for Milk. He has position on the block but passes it back out. Perunicic back into the ball game, shaking off that injury. And another foul on the perimeter. Ron Anderson picks it up.
Bulls foul number one, Ron Anderson Jr. That's his second foul.
Ron Anderson trying to be a bit aggressive over there on the baseline. Really no reason to commit a foul that far away from the basket.
Jared Famous in for Torlin Fitzpatrick. 13 and a half to go. 4-point lead for USF, and the zone is back. It was effective in the first half and gave USF a lift. Let's see if it can have the same effect here. instead an open look in the corner, Trivich.
Now, when the guards gets overloaded on the baseline side, the opposing forward has to bump everyone over. There was no communication that time by the backside forward.
Trivich has his first points of the season. Coming off the bench here in the second half to cut the deficit to one. Nice find there. Ron Anderson can't finish. Stays with the play. The ball loose on the baseline. And over the end line was Milt. So USF will have it.
Ron Anderson wishing he had that one back. Not often you find yourself as a 6'8 player with someone who's listed as 6 foot in their program, but I want to bring out the measuring tape on that one.
Bulls have a size and an athletic advantage at almost every position on the court. We haven't seen them been able to capitalize a whole lot, but not a lot of easy inside buckets in the paint.
Right. I mean, I think, again, it comes a little bit to the experience. I mean, St. Francis is a very experienced ball club, and they're taking advantage of that.
And there'll be five fouls on each team as we're inside of 13 minutes to go in the game. Dre Calloway, the freshman, grabs Crater for his first. Both teams racking up the fouls early. This game could be decided at the free throw line. Something to keep an eye on as we go. Glenn Branca commanding his troops. Noriega, a good look at a three, a bit too strong. Robertson fights for the rebound. Perunicic away with it at half court, and Crater bumped him.
Not sure about that one. Anthony Crater, I thought, did a great job of trying to run that basketball down. Robertson had an opportunity to reel in that rebound. That's one you got to snatch with two hands instead of trying to get one hand on it.
Augustus Gilchrist back into the ballgame. The revolving door at the scores table continues. See if that depth and rotation pays off down the stretch for these Bulls. 12:45 to go. They're in the zone defensively. Calloway looking for a seam over to Cadell. Sends Robertson flying and puts down another. Ricky Cadell gives St. Francis the lead. Robertson, does he have the answer? No. Perunicic clears glass. Here's Cadell once more. Stops and pops. Trivich the putback and a foul on Gilchrist.
Dan Heath is trying to wait for the 12-minute TV timeout to come, the media timeout. I don't know if he can afford to do that. St. Francis right here with an opportunity for two back-to-back three-point plays. Cadell, after hitting one, just has a heat check, and USF not hustling to get back, and Trivich.
We'll take a timeout here. St. Francis has scored 9 unanswered points. They have a 4-point lead with 12:19 to go. Welcome back to Tampa, where the Bulls had a 10-point lead as they came storming out of the halftime locker room. But ever since, it's been all Terriers. 14 unanswered points. They've taken a 48-44 lead here at the Sun Dome, and that's eerily reminiscent of what happened here on Friday night against Southern Miss when the Bulls led by as many as 9 with 8 minutes left, and then the faucet just completely turned off.
And you know that's in the back of some of these young players' mind, and they have to find a way to erase that from their memories. I mean, there's a reason why you play these games out, and someone has to find a way. You know, you want somebody to step up and be that leader on the floor to pull everybody together and say, you know what, guys? Everybody goes on runs. We had our run in the first half, then now had theirs. Now it's time for us to answer.
And Trivich at the free throw line with the chance to convert a three-point play. He misses, so the lead stuck on 4. Gilchrist the rebound. See if the Bulls have an answer. So a long way to go in this ball game as we approach the 12-minute mark. Haynes playing alongside Crater, a two-guard lineup. They're going to have to get it done at the free throw line eventually. Both teams now in the bonus the rest of the way.
Well, Augustus Gilchrist, shot nearly 70% from the free throw line last year, so I know he had a terrible night on Friday. He's the man I'd be wanting to get the ball to right now.
Poland will trigger the inbound. Crater gets an open look and a huge three to put the Bulls back in the scoring column.
About leadership and the answer. And right there, Anthony Crater found a way to dig down and knock one down.
Cuts the lead to 1. Not a score first guard, but when we needed it, he answered. Inside of 12 to go. Cadell with 16 on the shot clock. That crossover is wicked. Poland poked it away. A scramble for it. Cadell wins it. Crater tips it out of bounds. The shot clock reset, and it should not have. Stan Heath wants to make sure the officials check that shot clock because it was winding down on the Terriers. We'll take a timeout and get it straightened out for you, as he discussed with the officials. But off the inbound, a Crater three has cut the deficit to 1. Minutes to play here in Tampa. USF being challenged by St. Francis out of Brooklyn Heights. 48-47, the Terriers with the lead. Give you a quick game reset. Both teams have 3 timeouts remaining. And both teams will be in the bonus the rest of the way. St. Francis basketball, again, 11:29 on the clock, and they did reset the shot clock to 10 seconds. Cadell having trouble on the inbound. Crater pressuring Callaway in the backcourt with nine. He'll have to hurry. Crater in his jersey. Careful not to reach here. Over the top. Famous comes down with the board.
Coming up on a stop where you really need one. And he talked about Crater, you know, thinking shoot second. And right there, that was one I thought he definitely could have pulled.
And Poland reaches in and takes the foul at half court.
Bulls foul number five, Jawanza Poland.
Right there, just a miscommunication by both Crater and Augustus Gilchrist. Augustus Gilchrist, you know, had the man on his back and was able to swim around for a spin move. By that time, it was too late. The ball was already in the air.
Three fouls on Poland. Crater has three as well. No other foul trouble of note for USF at this stage. Front end of the 1-1 is good for Callaway. Missed the second. The lead is two. Shedrick Haynes. Famous over to Poland. He goes right by his man all the way to the rim. Jawanza Poland and a free throw coming.
Jawanza Poland looked like he had illusions of grandeur right then. I tell you what, if it wouldn't have been for that foul, I'm pretty sure that would have been a Sports Center highlight.
His eyes got big.
Poland was good. He'll hit the line and shoot one.
Jawanza Poland, unbelievable athlete. His ability to play basketball, but also was a track star, as you can see with the one-leg high jump.
Here's the Bulls the lead here, 50-49, inside of 11 to go. Cadell guarded by Crater. USF back in the man-to-man. Vunicic finds Callaway. And now Milk. Here's the Serbian, driving baseline, stopped by Poland, a turnover. Crater crosses over. Shedrick Haynes thought better of it. Now Gilchrist, there's the feed they've been looking for. Famous inside.
How about Jared Famous keeping the ball high? Anthony Carter, Anthony Crater, not able to keep his feet, tripping over the half court line, the 3-point line twice.
Famous picks up the foul, trying to take the charge at the defensive end. We get another look at the secondary break, and it leads to an